welcome to another edition of Between Two Spurs. I'm Matt Bonner, here with my good buddy, my fellow redhead, my fellow Mamba, the White Mamba, Brian Scalabrine. Scal, how's everything going? How's being stuck in home all these weeks?
I was just telling you earlier, the biggest difference is the weather. When it's sunny out, I'm outside, I'm being active, I'm doing stuff in the yard. All these laundry lists of hobbies that I've had that I've always wanted to do, I am doing those things. But when the weather turned and it's 42 degrees and rainy, it's kind of miserable just being stuck inside. But I'll get out there a little bit. But when those sunny days come, and you know what it's like in the Northeast, the sunny days come, especially after a long winter, you just love being outside. So I have a little love-hate relationship with quarantine right now.
That's funny because we're getting to like the complete opposite end of the spectrum with that issue here in San Antonio, where it's starting to get, so it's like 95, 96, humid out. So that, especially, you know, with red hair and pale skin, you can't go outside because it's too hot and sunny. We're not worried about the snow and cold and rain.
So have you mastered going out in the sun yet? Because I just came off of this all-star break. I came off of a 10-day vacation in Mexico where I did not apply sunblock one time. Now, I was a shirty in the pool, like off and on, and I had a big old giant hat, not sombrero, but it was big. But I've bailed on sunblock, and I just am a shirty now, a hoodie, long sleeves, and I exposed myself to 20 minutes every hour, and I did all right. So my challenge to you, Matt, I want you to take the redhead ginger pale skin challenge and see if you can go a day outside without putting any sunblock on.
That is such a middle-aged dad move right there. I love it. We actually went on vacation once to Jamaica, and we're at the resort, and my wife and kids are like, come on, come on, come swimming, come jump in the pool. But it's like, no, it's sunny out. It's in the 90s. It's 1 o'clock in the afternoon. That's a recipe for disaster. And then I remember like every afternoon at like 3, it would rain for an hour, and everybody would clear out of the pool, and that's where I was like, cannonball, and I'd jump in, and I'd be splashing, having a great time because the cloud covered the sun.
You know how in the resorts, all the windows face the pool. All the parents were looking like, look at that guy out there with the red hair. Look how crazy that guy is.
I love it. All right, well, hey, let's shift gears a little bit. So two of our longtime running mates have just been inducted into are going to be inducted into the Basketball Hall of Fame. For you, Kevin Garnett, for myself, Timmy Duncan. What are your kind of thoughts of this amazing Hall of Fame induction class and your teammate KG and Timmy Duncan, who you played against for so many years?
You know what's great is like I really when I talk to kids now, and you know, you do a lot of this, like people asking for advice, and you like talk to big groups of kids. I tell them, you got to be who you are. That's the best way to be the best player you can be. You can't act like somebody that you're not. And you use those two guys, both dominant players, but on the completely opposite ends of the spectrum as far as like personality. Like, I don't know what Tim was like off the court. I know like Garnett on the bus, on the plane, he's super funny. He's energetic. He wants the best for everybody. On the practice floor, he's all business. On the game floor, he's all business, and he's super intense, talks a lot of smack. My dealings with Tim is like a guy who just goes to work, does his job every single day, is not caught up in all the extra stuff. But both guys dominant, both guys first ballot Hall of Famers, both guys embracing their own personalities.
Yeah, I agree with that for sure. I think, you know, having that competitive streak, like, you know, I remember playing against KG. You're right. He would talk a lot of trash. I'm moving because my neighbor just fired up his lawnmower right next to me. It's funny that it happened the last time I did a Zoom interview, the same thing happened. So I'm gonna come in here. Anyways, I remember playing against KG. Like you knew you had to bring it, or he was going at your neck, and he was gonna let you hear about it the whole game, and he was gonna test you. He was gonna hit you when the refs weren't looking. Not in like a super dirty way, just in like a competitive mean streak type of way. Cause he wanted to win, and he wanted to assert himself. And I feel like Timmy was the same level of competitiveness, but to your point, yeah, more of like a quiet kind of silent assassin, go about his work more by example. I mean, he'd speak up when he had to, but same thing, like, if you didn't bring it, those guys brought it every night. That's what's amazing for like, so 20 years. Like, I can't imagine that. I mean, I was, yeah. I'm sure you could say, like we were role players off the bench, in and out of the rotation, even towards the end of the career for 12 years. And if you told me, look, you're gonna play another 8 years, 34 or 35 minutes a game, I'd tell you, come on, that's impossible.
I agree with you completely. I don't, it's so hard to imagine how hard these guys work who average 32 to 36 minutes a night, every single night. Then they bring it for practice. Then they bring it in the weight room. Then they bring it for shoot around. Like, it's no days off for the stars. And I think that's really amazing. One thing we should mention, if we're bringing up KG, I know I told you this story, but it's great for TV, right? Or Zoom interviews for that. Remember when you came to Boston and you were blitzing us in the first half? I mean, you were torching us in the first half. So anyways, Paul Pierce sits right next to KG, and Paul is the greatest at knowing how to, like, poke the bear, right? So Paul Pierce stands up at halftime before the coaches came in. It's like, hey, man, who has Matt Bonner? And he knew Garnett had Matt Bonner, right? So who's got Bonner? Someone's got to step up and take Bonner. Big Baby, you going to step up and take Bonner? Scal, you going to step up and take Bonner? By the way, his best friend on the team is getting blitzed by you, right? All of a sudden, KG has a water bottle with the cap on. And he was so furious. He squeezed the water bottle, and the cap flew off in water. It took me – I've had, you know, like, all the willpower in the world – not to fall on the floor crying that this thing is happening right now. But that was just an unbelievable story.
I remember that game. That was one of my, like, when I look back at my career, one of my fondest memories, just because, you know, being from the area, I mean, like, busloads of people would come down 93 from New Hampshire to watch that game. So going into that game, I always had, like, so much adrenaline. Coach Pop would usually have to call a timeout 2 minutes into my rotation, tell me to just calm down, take a deep breath. So when everything clicked and went right that game, it was great. But what I remember is in the second half, coming out of halftime, I check into the game and KG's eyes light up. He starts, like, foaming at the mouth. I inbound the ball, and I start running up the court, and he picks me up full court. Does the old, like, camp of champions slap the ground, defense. He's, like, right in my face, like, snarling. And I'm like, oh, my God, it's the third quarter. I just checked in. Please don't kill me. So now I know why.
Yeah. It's funny when we have games like that. Like, I had in game five of the Pistons series, it was a triple overtime, and I was getting wide open shot after wide open shot, knocking him down. And I'm like the hero of the game, right? But there's still game six and game seven to play. And I remember playing in game six and seven, and I didn't even see the hoop. And they were all in my face. Like, I didn't want the ball anymore, Matt. I just had, like, the greatest game of my career, and I'm going in so confident. And every time I got a catch, it was like, I had to get rid of the ball. Because once they know you're on the scouting report and those dudes, like, raise their level, there's nothing I could have done about it.
I totally know the feeling. You and I have a lot of similarities, Scal.
You mean, like, besides the fact that we're both pale-skinned redheads that play in the NBA?
Exactly. I mean, every time I fly into Boston, going from getting off the plane to the parking garage, at least one or two people will think I'm you and, like, want a picture and be like, oh, my gosh, the White Mamba. Scal, come here. Can you take a picture with me? And I don't tell them. I'm just like, yeah, sure. Make sure you post this.
I know your personality. Like, to me, I think you're the funniest type of funny, right? Like, the dry sense of humor where you say jokes but you're not really sure about it. I get all across my mentions all the time. Me and Scalabrine at the airport, I'm like, dude, I'm in Phoenix right now. How am I in the Boston airport?
They've been playing all, you know, since KG and Timmy are getting inducted into the Hall of Fame, they've been playing a lot of their old games. I don't know if you've noticed, like, on ESPN, ESPN Classic, NBA TV. And every time, you know, I'll watch the old, I'm hungry for basketball right now. I'm sure you are too. And so I like watching the old games, and they'll show you on the bench, or maybe you're in the game, and we have a little year and a half year old toddler, and she'll point at the screen, "Dada, dada, dada." And she'll look at me like,
nah. I got the text message about, what do I remember about San Antonio?
Yes.
And the thing that stands out, you know, like my second year in the NBA, we made the NBA finals and we were playing the Spurs. So you know, I go through the NBA finals and the things that I remember, we had some kind of windstorm flying into that. And we had to circle the runway like three times just to land. And everybody on the plane was like, let's just go to Dallas. Let's just fly to Houston. Let's just go somewhere else and land. Because it was like, by the third time, the pilot just like slams the plane on the ground. Every time we would come down and get shifted, right? So then you remember that. But in game six of that series, we had a huge lead in the third quarter. And the Nets that year, we were great in transition, and we were a subpar team in half court and really bad when Jason Kidd was off the floor. Jason Kidd subbed out of the game, and you guys were on a run. And the only thing I remember is the loudest building I've ever been in and the PA announcer saying, "Go, Spurs, go!" And we bang a timeout, and the crowd would kind of calm down. Then the PA announcer would say, "Go, Spurs, go!" And then we'd bang a timeout, and it just went over. Matt, that run was so significant. I think we had like – maybe we were up 17 in the third. Like, I don't remember the exact amount. And then we lost by 14. And all I can remember was the run that the Spurs went on. And there was, like, nothing we can do. There was not enough timeouts in the history of the NBA that can get us out of this run. We couldn't right the ship. It was, you know, young Tony Parker, young Ginobili, and Timmy D. I mean, it was just – unbelievable, that environment during that game six. And then we had to take the bus ride back to the hotel. It took like 3 hours to get there and the fans. But I always remembered, as tough as the fans were in the arena, they were the nicest people outside, like on the boardwalk or going out to eat and stuff like that.
Yeah, that, you know, San Antonio fans are great on the court. We're the only show in town, really. So it's just such a tradition and so ingrained in the culture generationally here in San Antonio. And that was something when I got traded here, you know, it's hard to win here. You know that anyone who plays in the NBA knows how hard it is to win in San Antonio, and you realize quickly why, because it's not just the guys on the team. It's like the whole city. You got to beat the whole city. But you're right. Really nice people. That's one thing I think that you can compare San Antonio with the Celtics, just a very long, rich basketball tradition, which I think is really cool.
Yeah, I mean, I even feel like even without Duncan and without, like, you know, the big three or whatever, it's still been just a great environment. You always have, and I don't know if it's because we're trained this way and all those years of how intense this game was going to be, but every time you walk into that building, you still feel like, This is a big game. This is the big building. This is a hard game where it's going to win. Even though, like, the Spurs record at home was just whatever this year, it was still, you just had that feeling that, and maybe it's because of the banners and the retired jerseys and all the history and maybe Pop on the sideline, whatever it may be, it's still an amazing place to go and watch a game, or now I call games for the Celtics. It's the same. You still have that edge. It's going to be different.
Last thing, Scal. You have a spaghetti sauce.
I do.
I was checking my social media one time, and I saw a tweet about your spaghetti sauce. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so a guy who has worked with Terry Francona here in the area, he's worked with a lot of the people out in Cleveland as far as like a salsa, and he approached me, and this is something I'm really into cooking. I like, me and my wife, after a long day, whether it's in quarantine or not, And you know how it is when you have kids and you're super busy. You rarely get a chance to, like, get into the kitchen and just, like, have that rhythm between you and your wife and just hanging out and, like, doing something productive. And I'm really into healthy food. I'm really into what goes into my body, even more so now than when I was a player, just because of the stuff you read out there. And I just wanted to provide like my the stuff that I do, the sauce that we've been making for all these years. We used to make our own versus buying what's on the shelf. And someone approached me and said, "Hey, is this something that you really want to do?" I went to my agent. It's like, "Yeah, I would love to, man." Plus it's a different area of something I've never done before, so I'm really interested in doing it. So I got approached to do the sauce. I ended up doing it, and I love it, man. It's really my sauce. What goes into it? It's not that sweet. It's more. You really taste the flavor. So I got into that, and I'm loving understanding how like the grocery store sector works. And I hope I can continue and turn this into like what Paul Newman did, and just, you know, like learning more about, you know, like different things that go into our bodies and having a big name, at least here in the New England area.
How do you get it? Do they sell it at grocery stores up there? Like, yeah. Shaw's and Market Basket?
Yeah,
and
Shaw's, Roach Brothers, some of the smaller ones like Donnelly's. And we're continuing to this right now, what's going on, everything kind of goes on hiatus, all the different meetings.
Right, right.
But Matt, I've been sitting in. It's amazing when you enter into something you don't know and how it works. Like, I didn't know how grocery stores work. Now I kind of do. So it's just something that really sparked my interest. I love food. I love cooking and all that stuff. But just understanding how this business works was really a part of what drove this as well. And yeah, you can get it at all the places. And yeah, just go online and follow me. And I always send out different things that I'm doing, like sampling and stuff like that.
That's awesome. Maybe we can try to get it into our HEB's grocery stores down here in Texas.
By the way, the greatest commercials are the HEB commercials.
Oh, no question.
Have to deal with the Spurs. I don't know who's running that. He's probably some exec that's like some major, major place now, but he is the man. I love those commercials.
I know. And to get the players to buy in is the best part of all in. Well, hey, we got to chat. Maybe I can get some salsas going on down here in San Antonio.
Yeah. Hey, listen, I know a guy. Matt, if you want to get it done, we'll get it done.
Listen, everyone gives me so much grief down here because, you know, I'm from New England. I put ketchup on everything, including my breakfast tacos. Like, breakfast tacos are like the thing down here. When I first got here, there were hardly any breakfast spots, and I'm like, where does people eat breakfast around here? And they're like, oh, they get breakfast tacos, and I'd never even heard of them. So I've been eating breakfast tacos the last 15 years I've been here, putting ketchup on them. So maybe I need to develop a salsa that I would put on my breakfast tacos.
Yeah. You know, you can develop a salsa that has like a ketchup flair to it. And if you really think about it, it could be like a baby step for kids that want to get into salsa eventually. But you know how kids, they love ketchup. So there's definitely a market for that. So, hey, listen, hit me on the text. You got my number.
I will.
Clearly.
I will.
And,
I'll
get you a guy, man. I think you make the ingredients. You put the ketchup and the salsa together. You make it how you like it, and you'll be surprised how fun this kind of sector is.
All right, sounds like a plan. Anyways, Scal, I'll let you get back to your family. You homeschooling your kids?
I am. I love it. I love it. It's great. You have no idea what your kids are good at and not good at until you homeschool them, and then you realize, like, wow. You could be good at math and then like miss out on just a small part, and then you can address that issue. I'm telling you, Matt, I really loved doing this. I don't want to do this forever, and I feel for people that are going through all this, but this is the best version of my outside of basketball self I've ever lived in my life. So I've enjoyed it, and maybe it's kind of how you are too. Listen, give me the rules of life. I will follow the rules of life, and I will thrive in those rules.
I will grind. I will pound the rock. Thank goodness my wife does so much. She does all the cooking, and I take care of the homeschooling stuff. But you're right. You develop a plan. You attack it day after day. And Scal, once again, man, as always, great chatting with you. Thanks for coming on Between Two Spurs. And we'll have to do this again sometime, and hopefully we get basketball back before we know it.
You got it, my man. I'll talk to you later.
All right. Take care.